Right, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this, the first meeting in 2015 of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee. Can I welcome all members, welcome our witnesses, and welcome those joining us in the public gallery. And then can I remind everyone, please, to turn off or at least turn to silent all mobile phones and other electrical devices so they don't interfere with the sound equipment. We have apologies this morning from Chick Brodie and from Joan McAlpin, although Joan hopes she might be able to join us a bit later. And we are joined by Bruce Crawford, who's here as a substitute member. Welcome. We do have a change in committee members, so I'd like to first of all pay tribute to those who have left us. Both Richard Baker and Margaret McDougall were members of this committee for quite some time, and we'd like to thank them for their contribution to the work of the committee and wish them success in their new berths in the Parliament. And I'd like to welcome two new members, Joan Lamont and Lewis Macdonald. Thank you for joining us this morning. Item one on the agenda is a declaration of interest, firstly from our new members and then from our substitute member. So if I could invite, first of all, Joan Lamont to indicate if she has any relevant interests she wishes to declare.
I don't have any, thanks.
Okay, thank you. And Lewis Macdonald?
I refer to the Register of Interests.
Okay, thank you. And Bruce Crawford?
I have nothing relevant to declare.
Okay, thank you. Item two on the agenda, are the committee agreed that we will take item four in private?
I agree.
That's agreed, thank you. Item three on the agenda, we are taking evidence in relation to our inquiry on the economic impact of the creative industries. Can I just put on record our thanks as a committee to those who attended the event we held last Wednesday evening. I know a number of committee members were there, and I thought it was a very useful opportunity for us to learn from people in the sector some of the challenges and issues that were facing them, as well as being a very enjoyable opportunity to explore and experience some of the products on offer. But there were a whole range of themes that came from that, some of which I think we can explore in the session this morning, around the diversity of the sector, levels of support, some of the challenges that are being faced. Some of that is brought out in terms of the written submissions that we've had as a committee. So I'd like to welcome our panel this morning. If I can just introduce you briefly, starting on my left-hand side, we have Paul Durrant, who's Director of Business Development at Abertay University. Brian Baglow, who's Director of the Scottish Games Network. Colin Macdonald, who's the Games Commissioner for Channel 4. And Chris van der Kuyl, who's Chairman of 4J Studios. So welcome to you all, and thank you for coming along. Now, we've got about 90 minutes for this session. What I'm intending to do is, given we have quite a range of written submissions, is not ask you to make opening statements, but I'm sure we can pick up the points that you're keen to get across in terms of the questions that are going to be asked. Because there are four of you, what I'm going to do is ask the members if they would, when they're asking questions, rather than just throw them open, in which case you'll all feel that you want to have a say, perhaps ask members if they would specifically direct their questions initially at one member of the panel, and then if you want to come in and contribute to that discussion, if you just catch my eye, I will bring you in as best as I can. And if I can exhort members to keep their questions as short and to the point as possible, and answer similarly as short and to the point as possible, that would be very helpful in terms of getting through what is quite a broad range of topics we want to cover in the time that's available to us. I wonder if I could start off by picking up an issue that is covered in a number of written submissions. It's covered in the submission from yourself, Brian, about a lack of national strategy or vision for the sector. And I raise this because it is reflected in quite a lot of the evidence we've had. The submission from Colin Anderson, who's the managing director of Denki, who sets out in his written submission his view that the primary issue affecting the digital media sector at the moment is the lack of a commonly held vision and clearly defined long-term strategy that all government agencies, departments, investors, businesses, etc., can use as the basis for aligning their endeavours. And he goes on to expand on this and why he thinks there's need for a national digital network for Scotland. I wonder if I can maybe just start off maybe with yourself, Brian, asking you whether you agree with that. I think you do, because it's in your submission too. But explain why you think this is the case and what needs to be done to try and address it. Then I'll bring the others in to see if they want to comment.
Absolutely, yes. Good morning, everyone. And can I just echo the chairman's thanks for your participation at last week's showcase. It was fantastic, and all the games companies were incredibly happy that we saw so many members there. The lack of strategy in the digital sector is a very widespread phenomenon, not just in Scotland, but across the UK. It is an incredibly rapidly evolving industry, and one in which new devices, new gadgets, new routes to market, new business models appear all the time. And this forces the industry to constantly change and constantly run to keep up. And as such, the support that's on offer is sometimes out of date by the time it's implemented. And without any kind of long-term strategy or any real vision about pulling digital media or pulling all of the creative industries together using digital media and interactive technology, then we can only ever hope to be reactive. And we certainly can't go out and actually plan our future in a really effective way. I mean, let's be honest, interactive media is a transformative technology as well as a type of content. And it is radically affecting all of the industries that you're going to be talking to, film, television, music, literature, and you know the wider issues in sectors like healthcare, education, even politics, sports, and you know fitness. All of these things are being affected by digital media. And the game sector has the creativity and the technical prowess to really drive all of these things forward, but it's still treated as very much a silo and an insular kind of content in its own right, rather than the transformative technology it could be.
Okay, thank you. I'm keen to get all the panelists to comment briefly on this. Maybe, Paul, you want to go next?
Yeah, thanks. I think for me, yes, strategies are important, and certainly in terms of membership of the industry leadership group most closely associated with this sector, there is work ongoing to try and further develop and refresh a strategy that's been articulated in the past. That's all important. But one of the themes that I'll return to a number of times is that creating the right ecosystem for everything to happen that needs to happen in terms of economic development in the game sector is more important, and strategies alone can't make that happen. There's a lot of serendipity, and it's almost like making your own luck. And some of the things that we need to do need to make our own luck, essentially, in this. And there are fantastic opportunities for the agencies that support them, and those that you might think need to be, you know, connected into strategies and visions. Most of that has too much of a lag to have a real impact in what's a fast moving sector. So I won't dwell on it now, but suffice to say that for me it's much more about making the right ecosystem, and that happens with a lot of small things rather than a shiny strategy.
I mean, I think your point about serendipity is interesting, because one of the things that struck me and some colleagues after the event last Wednesday was how diverse the sector is, how much is going on, how many companies there are, and it really is hit and miss in many cases whether a very good product ends up being successful, whether it's spotted or not, and whether it gets the right level of marketing and attention. Colin.
Thank you. I do think there could be more joining up of strategy across the different agencies and across the sector. And I do think Colin Anderson's idea of a national digital network is interesting. I think it would help. I think my fear comes from what's achievable, that I'm conscious that this is a very fast-moving industry. Anything we put in place today is going to be out of date next year or within a couple of years, worst case. And I'd be keen to see focus on things that will adapt to the changing nature of things, albeit driven by a strategy, but not one that takes 2 years to put in place and is out of date within a year and a half.
Okay, thank you. Chris.
Thanks, Chairman. It's quite interesting because, you know, as this committee takes evidence from various creative industries, most of the messages that you will hear are messages of challenge within a sector of requirement for funding to in some way be competitive. The games sector doesn't need that. You know, we sit today with, as of last weekend, Sony's PlayStation charts, the top two games are both developed in Scotland. One being my own studio's Minecraft, that we develop all the console versions for here in Dundee and East Linton, and Rockstar's Grand Theft Auto V. I'm sure it won't have missed you that Rockstar are your new neighbours and have taken over the Scotsman headquarters, or the ex-Scotsman headquarters behind you. And there'll be somewhere in the region of 1,000 developers in there that will be the biggest single development studio Scotland has ever seen, and I think the biggest one in the UK by a long way. At that end, these businesses are incredibly successful and are really restricted only in their current and future success by access to talent. Actually, that's the common thread, I think, that pervades every part of the industry. In terms of things like the current fiscal regimes, both from a UK fiscal regime and then also support from the Scottish Government in terms of interventions around a number of grants and things, there's a pretty good infrastructure there that's accessible. I think where strategy comes into this is some level of coherence and understanding across the agencies, but also across those that are trying to access it, could definitely be helpful in terms of information signposting. But the real issue, and I'm sure it's one we'll get onto in far more detail, is a strategy around talent. And that's both creation of Indigenous talent, but also attraction and retention of non-Indigenous and, in many cases, international talent. And that, to me, is the single issue that we really need to think of in the most broad sense possible.
Okay, thanks for that. And certainly it's on our agenda this morning to talk about skills, education and provision of talent. But just before we leave this issue of a strategy, I just want to briefly get a response from you on a follow-up question, which is this. If there's going to be a strategy, who puts that in place? Who drives it? Chris?
I think it has to be a reasonably broad conversation, but I think it has to be owned by the industry. I mean, where we've had success in the past, we had a phenomenal engagement with Scottish Enterprise that began in the mid-1990s, where they supported the real establishment of Scotland as a brand in the games industry. And that was driven by the industry going to Scottish Enterprise and saying, or actually Scottish Enterprise saying, we don't know what to do to help you, what could we do? And we coalesced it in that case around the biggest annual trade show in the world, E3. And from that day to this, we've had a real positive presence as Scotland at that trade show. And that was in no small part, a part of Scotland's success since then. But equally, the biggest and best thing they did is they got the industry in a room. I think it started off at an informal dinner at Dunblane Hydro, where we managed to get together in the centre of Scotland and kind of discuss the issues that were facing us and come to some common ground. Bringing the industry together, it's much, much bigger today than it was, than it was sort of 15 or even 20 years ago. But even so, it's still small enough that we could get the key players in a room and the supporting agencies to try and come up with some coherent view of how we develop a strategy.
Thanks. Brian?
It has to be industry-driven. The public sector bodies, the organisations, don't have the expertise in-house in many cases. Scottish Enterprise, SDI, HIE, being exceptions, they do a lot of really good work. But the industry has to drive this forward in conjunction with the public sector, government and Parliament.
Okay. Colin, Paul, do you agree with that?
Generally, yes. I think it should be... The industry needs to feel it owns it and needs to drive a lot of the agenda. I think the only thing I'd caution is that we're still quite a young industry. We're not particularly mature. We're not great at figuring out that long-term strategy. We're not great at engaging with government. So I think we'd need to be shepherded by someone to make sure something came out of it that was implementable.
And for me, again, I'd say rather than it be industry contributing to some kind of glossy strategic document or even some kind of online thing that's updated regularly, it is much more about just continued engagement with industry to build this ecosystem as a kind of a talent magnet, rather than thinking about some long-term piece of work to create a strategy. because that will be out of date. But industry at the heart of it and leading on it, certainly.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to bring in Dennis Robertson, who thinks those questions around funding.
Okay, thank you, Kavita, and good morning, gentlemen. Perhaps maybe start with yourself, Paul. The submission from Professor White from Abertay, one of the things I think he was highlighting was some of the startup funding. I wonder how difficult is it to access the appropriate funding within the industry, to encourage maybe that initial entrepreneurship or maybe just to take forward the initial ideas?
I think it can have its challenges, but talented teams with good projects will probably be able to find the funding. The rationale for potentially intervening in this sector with some kind of early stage funding, and you'll see that a number of the submissions have referred to the UK prototype fund that I used to run, is more to do with contributing to that ecosystem and making sure there's a volume of new IP being developed, making sure that there are real world projects that can employ talent and particularly take on new graduates or encourage graduates to be entrepreneurial in their own right, to encourage people to exercise their leadership and entrepreneurial skills in real world situations rather than learning through the classroom. Now, you might think that's a rather odd justification for intervening in this way, but for me, with everything that I learned with the 3 or 4 years of running that fund, the biggest impact and the biggest value came from us really funding that ecosystem. So to answer your question, yes, funding's a challenge, but I think the challenge is more about providing funding so that volume of new starts, new activities, talent and diverse talent coming together to do interesting stuff is the important thing, rather than just seeing this as a bunch of potential startups that are saying they can't get investment, which is the standard story that you hear.
Do you think then some type of mentoring scheme would be important? Because one of the things that we heard from an earlier panel was that someone might have the idea, and it might be one of the best ideas there, but at the end of the day, they just can't manage the sort of accountancy side, they can't manage the sort of business aspect of pulling it together. So they've got the idea, but they just don't have the business acumen to take it forward. Do you think we need to look at shepherding people through that?
We absolutely do, and for everything that I've said about there being a case for public intervention around that, it can only happen where there's a really robust discipline around the way that those projects are sort of managed and overseen and connected into expertise. We're so fortunate in Scotland to have expertise, people like Chris and Colin, Dave Jones, Brian running the Scottish Games Network. There's a huge wealth of experience for new starts to tap into. We need to perhaps formalise that and put a bit of a structure and a wrapper around it to a certain extent, because if we are going to use some public funding at any point to incentivise these kind of startups, the discipline, those kind of mentoring schemes are very, very important. And there are some good examples, as a number of submissions have referred to internationally, where there's been a kind of joined up way of thinking.
I think Dennis, Chris van der Kuyl, yeah, keen to come
fine.
In.
Yeah, that's fine. Very briefly to try to come in on that point, Dennis. I think one of the things is the games industry is not overly unique in those core requirements for basic entrepreneurial skills, and a lot, as you say, people come out with great talent in their sector without really knowing how to build a business. I think we're very fortunate in Scotland I slight declared interest, I'm the chairman of Entrepreneurial Scotland that also runs the Saltire Foundation, in having organisations like that which are all about peer mentoring, are all about bringing through people with high growth ambition into great programmes, but equally programmes like the high growth side of Scottish Enterprise, but also the fantastic incubator culture and accelerator culture that we now have, as evidenced by, you'll be well aware of, I'm sure, Entrepreneurial Spark and things like TechCube here in Edinburgh. And those types of organisations, of which we're looking to see more across the country, are the ones that need, so they don't need to be entirely sector specific for games. They just need to be, you know, the same people that are trying to start digital media businesses in tourism will have the same challenges in terms of basic running of their business as those that are trying to start games companies. So we already are pretty well provided, and I think can continue to do so.
That's good. That's interesting. Brian, want to come in?
Yeah, again, very briefly to follow up on Paul and Chris's points. One of the issues that we have is that we are producing more and more original new intellectual property. Last year, 2013, Scotland produced 93 games, 86 of which were original new IP. In the last year, 2014, it was round about 85, 86, of which round about 82 were original new intellectual property. It's not the creation process. Content is in some ways cheap. What we're lacking is the skills for any company, any new company, to go out and operate sustainably. I'm entirely with Chris. The amount of help and support out there from Business Gateway, the Chambers of Commerce, through eSpark, all of the various accelerators, is exceptional. What we have is a lack of business sense. People get into the games industry because they want to make games. Not running a company as a byproduct. It's very much the same as some of the other areas of the creative industries. It's just that in games, a really small team can go out and produce something quite simply and quite cheaply. And wehey, they're a games company. So we need to actually take that forward. And it's going from the amateur, the part-time team, through to a sustainable business where we have problems. I think a mentoring scheme could help that tremendously.
Okay. I'm just wondering, just a follow-up to that, Ryan. I mean, obviously, you mentioned the Gateway, for instance, and I'm just wondering, you know, are people aware of the potential to get support and maybe the initial financial support that's there? You know, are other agencies proactive at promoting the support that's available? And the other thing, coming back to the finances, I mean, to promote some aspects, I mean, surely within the private sector, the banks, it would appear, are still very reluctant to engage because it's a high risk.
It is indeed a high risk. When you're looking at any creative sector that is a hit-driven industry, then getting institutional investment of any kind can be difficult. And I'll defer to Chris on that, as he's got the expertise in those areas. But I think the key issue here is that we have a growing number of new teams and new companies which are forming. We now have 4 universities and round about 6 colleges producing game-specific graduates. So the number of new companies is only going to rise, because the opportunities for those graduates are now primarily entrepreneurial. We don't have the huge studios that we once did, Rockstar aside. And so we're going to get more and more games companies, and the smart ones will go out and find Business Gateway and talk to the local Chamber of Commerce. But the vast majority of people coming into games tend to come from technical backgrounds or artistic backgrounds. You know, I've only ever worked for 3 different people in the game sector I would, you know, classify as entrepreneurial, who are willing to pivot and do what, change the company in order to be sustainable, in order to make money. And I think that's what we're missing. It's that entrepreneurialism.
Thank you, Brian. I think, to come in on that, there is no place for the normal clearing lending banks to be investing in small startup games companies. That would be the last thing any of us in this economy would want. It is on a high risk level. It's right at the top end of risk. But there are others. I mean, very, very recently, Tag Games in Dundee secured one of the first crowd lending loans from an Edinburgh-based organisation who were prepared to lend, because run by a technology entrepreneur called Bill Dobby, he understands the sector and decided it was worthy of risk. There is no shortage of finance. I referred earlier to the fiscal policies that currently prevail in the UK. I think the EIS scheme allows individual business angels to invest in a very tax-efficient way into companies like this, and they do. You know, so you know that's there. Games tax relief for the bigger organisations is certainly starting to make a difference, as we're starting to see big inward investors look to. You know, Brian said we'll never see the big studios again. I don't actually think that's true. I think we will, and we are already. They're just starting in different ways. There are significant businesses of scale, and it is also making sure that we don't get overly fixated on. Worrying too much about young companies and how they'll come through, in that the ones that are going to do it will find a way. You know, you mentioned every company, and I will probably end up mentoring in the course of a month five or six companies that will come through my door for advice into we want to get going, and I give them the same signpost that I give everyone. And of those, at least one of them will have followed up. The other four will be too busy, trying to build their next prototype. And those guys, and I defer to my colleague to my right, Colin, on this, will find, if they're really talented, they'll start to find relationships with organisations like Channel 4, who are publishers who commission and help them find their way through their early stages. That's always been the traditional route. We took that route. You know, we worked with publishers who guided us and helped us and gave us commissions, so we didn't necessarily work on our own intellectual property to start with. And then as time went by and we gained more experience and more expertise and more capital, we were able to take more risks ourselves, to the stage today where we don't have any external funding from publishers or anywhere else. It's purely self-generated. But Colin, you maybe want to comment on that.
Yeah, if I can come in. Just winding back, there was a question around Business Gateway, and I've not dealt with Business Gateway myself, but what I hear is that the advice is too generic, and when people do get into speaking to Scottish Enterprise, they can speak to digital media experts that understand the sector, and people's experience going in at a more generic level, it hasn't been great. One of the points that comes across all of this for me is the entrepreneurial thing, and I think that's probably the single thing I would recommend anyone look at for this sector. We have a nation of amazingly talented creative people and technical people that create world-breaking new IP. The problem is, as an industry, as a nation, we're rubbish at exploiting it. Many of our big successes, Grand Theft Auto, created in Dundee, still made here. Most of the money goes to the publisher in the States. Lemmings was created here. Minecraft, although Scotland's doing very well out of it, it's not a Scottish IP intrinsically. We need to make our companies more entrepreneurial, make them less focused about just having their heads down and creating the next interesting thing and getting payroll in for next month, and thinking, never mind payroll for next month, let's think about that and how do we make millions, how do we make billions. I think the likes of the Prototype Fund was fantastic from my point of view, because it gave teams an opportunity to experiment at relatively low cost, and it gave them essential skills that they could build companies out of the team they'd gone into Prototype Fund, take into new ventures, or even just take into other employers. Things like the Dare to Be Digital competition that Abertay also runs. Same thing, a bunch of students that in the course of a summer get real-life commercial experience, and at the end of the day go shopping around publishers. I commission one game every year out of it, and those teams learn a little something about deal-making and publishing and marketing. And I think the industry's got so many opportunities. A lot of game technology can be used in other industries. There is a lot of investment available. Not all of it is as well targeted as it can be at the moment, but I think you need people with those entrepreneurial ambitions to want to go after it, to sort of duck and dive and find their way around the systems, whereas so many of our talented games creators at the moment will take it if it lands on their lap, but they're more interested in creating something amazing than figuring out business plans and how to get investment, and we need to inject that entrepreneurial spirit into more of our future creators.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Paul, yes.
I just wanted to stress that although there is this vibrant sort of potential to secure funding for the right projects. As I said before, the idea that you have some kind of prototype funding that isn't there to address a finance gap, but is there to kind of pump prime the ecosystem and all of these talent projects is a really important one.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay. Patrick, do you want to come in on the funding issue or another issue?
Some of the issues that were raised in response to the questions on funding and finance. It's not specifically on funding and
okay,
finance.
Okay, well, I'll bring you in a bit later on with that.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah. Okay, I think next on my list is Joanne Lamont. Yeah.
Thanks very much, and thank you for coming along. I was interested in what you said about strategy. I think that for too often we have perfect strategies that bear no relation to what's going on. You know, lots of effort developing strategies across the board, but doesn't relate at all to what's happening on the ground, and I would have thought particularly challenging where almost inevitably you will always be ahead of the rest of us in understanding potential. And I think it's probably more generally true of the creative industries, how you actually deal with that. But I suppose I'm interested in, there was some comment earlier about university courses and college courses, and I'm interested in what links there are specifically between industry and these courses, how relevant they are. Because from my perspective, I'm very interested in seeing companies grow. That helps the Scottish economy. But if this is a new industry, how are we ensuring that our young people who have got talent, actually there is a system by which they get to it? So it's not entirely by chance or by good fortune of where you happen to be. It's in the interest of you to access the talent, but it's also the interest of young people who potentially might consider that as a career to have a route towards it. We know what the routes are for other professions and other jobs. So first of all, therefore, university and college, how do you make what they offer relevant to what you need? And also, how do you provide a path to reach into some of our communities and get young people doing the right things so that they get these kind of fantastic opportunities that you're describing?
Thank you, Chair. I think it's a very, very relevant point of inquiry. I mean, I think the 20 years ago, Joanne, we were all getting going in the industry, you know, the sort of 94-95 timescale. And one of the things we realised, because we're a few of us, and specifically myself and David Jones and a guy called Russell Kay in Dundee, were all trying to build quite big studios all on each other's doorstep. So we knew very quickly if we didn't find sources of talent to grow from, we'd all just try and steal from each other. Wages would go through the roof and we'd be out of business pretty quickly. And we went and approached Abertay University at that point, who had an idea that they wanted to do a virtual reality and virtual environments degree. And we convinced them to do something pretty radical at that point, which was not do that, which was quite generic and non-specific, but make it about computer games. And don't be embarrassed by it. This was an industry of the future. You know, as it's become, it's the world's biggest entertainment industry. And the University of Abertay in that 15, 20-year period has become the outstanding university in delivering games technology and games design and games management courses, and also building an ecosystem that goes into further education as well. You know, Dundee College specifically, but also across in the West, around UWS and a number of other institutions that are doing it. You know, you sit at the table in front of you, all four of us, obviously. Paul on a full-time basis, Colin on court, myself as a visiting professor, and Brian, you know, have all had deep interactions with that infrastructure for a long, long time. We've done phenomenally, all of us. I don't just mean the companies, I mean the whole sector, to build what we've managed to build. The challenges for us today is genuinely those universities are facing you know, an ever-tightening belt. You know, University of Abertay, obviously, in recent years hasn't had its troubles to seek. And if we don't really get behind what we've kicked off and what's taken 15 or 20 years to get here, I really am very, very concerned about that great work that's been done, not least of which Colin referred to the Dare to be Digital competition. As far as I'm aware, that's no longer going to be run in the same way. It's no longer going to be about incubating new talent. It's going to be more about demonstrating what Scotland's doing at the moment. That's not investing in the future. If we don't spend the vast majority of our intervention and our time as an ecosystem worrying about the talent supply, we don't have an industry. You know, the 1,000 people across the road will not be sustainable. You know, they're already seeing a really burgeoning sector in Scotland around all sorts of digital media that I'll happily come back and mention later. It's a phenomenal time for Scotland in the next 5 to 10 years for these related sectors. And the thing we all share in common is we need talent. Now, it's STEM as well. It's STEM subjects at school. Royal Society of Edinburgh did some great work in getting computer science back on the agenda in a positive way. There's a lot of initiatives around coding that are leading our younger children to realise that this kind of thing can be a route forward for them. Diversity is needed. It's been for far too long seen as a male-dominated sort of geeky-type subject. It's not. A very broad range of skills. As Colin mentioned, taking products to market is not all about software development. It's about marketing, it's about publishing, it's about analytics, all these new sort of digital economy roles. And one only needs to look at, I always say this, but one only needs to look at Seattle and the post-industrial, post-oil crisis time of Seattle in the 70s to Seattle today, which is one of the world's strongest digital economies, with not a particularly bigger population than Scotland. It's about equivalent. It was created in a 20-30 year time period by big businesses really wanting to focus there and build talent. And that's what we've got to do. So, I really commend you to look as strongly as possible at how you can support us on that basis.
Okay. Right. Yeah. As I said earlier, Scotland is very well provided with in terms of higher education. We have four universities. Abertay is, as Chris says, a world leader, a pioneer in offering game-specific courses. They've now been joined by Edinburgh Napier, Glasgow Caledonian and the University of the West of Scotland. And when it comes down to ties with industry and making sure that these courses are relevant, there are a number of ways that universities are doing this. Again, Abertay have six of their games courses accredited by Creative Skillset, which is the UK-wide body for skills and training. And the accreditation has an awful lot to do with ties with industry and ensuring that the content, the teaching, the learning outcomes are all relevant to what's happening within the industry. The same body also offers the Trainee Finder programme, which allows graduates from those courses to join up to a massive database, UK-wide database, and find companies that are looking for new talent, and Creative Skillset will actually fund 50% of the costs of taking those trainees on. As a route into the industry, it's exceptional. However, that was tied into the closing Skills Investment Fund, which was announced by the Westminster government. That has not as yet been renewed. So that programme is closing for Scotland, Northern Ireland and Wales, which leaves us with an awful lot of trainees out there who will be finishing at the end of this financial year. Hopefully they'll be moving into industry. But moving forward, it's certainly something that the Scottish Government could look at as a route into industry. If we have round about 850 students at Abertay, Paul, rough estimate would be around 1,200 to 1,300 students going through the various universities and colleges. And either they come out and join some of the smaller studios out there, or they set up on their own, or we try and provide those routes into market to give the smaller studios, which is the vast majority of the games-related companies in Scotland, the opportunity to bring new people on board.
Yeah, I think there's no doubt that the accreditation process and the high level of industry involvement in that has really helped bring on a kind of strong portfolio of courses at Abertay and elsewhere. And that's a really positive thing that we need to preserve. But there are a lot of other issues in that where we've been involved in other projects, such as the Prototype Fund, such as DARE, there isn't an easy way that funding for universities is kind of measured that takes account of the benefits of those types of impact. And that makes it very difficult. And notwithstanding the existence of SCIP, which is supposed to ensure that all the agencies, including the Funding Council, are kind of joined up in the way that they look at this and think about this, I've never managed to persuade anyone that some of the impacts that we've created from things like DARE and the Prototype Fund should be measurable outputs in the way that funding comes into universities. So in a sense, that's a disappointment. Just a couple of things picking up on this the wider questions. I do think, notwithstanding the accreditation process, that we need to make sure that we attract talent from as wide an area as possible now in the games industry, as all sorts of new audiences and markets are opening up. In Scotland, we've got some fabulous talent across all of the arts colleges. We've got fantastic talent doing computer science degrees. We need to make sure that some of those individuals are attracted into the sector. So there needs to be a lot happening in this kind of serendipitous ecosystem that I'm going to keep talking about, bringing those people in. But more than anything, and going back to this point about how we encourage younger people into the sector and get their sights set on this as a career choice, we need to do more to open the whole of that up, almost as a goldfish bowl, essentially, to schools, so that people see real-world projects in action. It's one of the things that we did a lot with DARE in terms of launching the showcase event Protoplay in the first place, and encouraging thousands of families to come along. That's the first step, but a lot more can happen. A lot more can happen if we have another stage of the prototype fund. A lot of that is predicated around making sure that, as a condition of getting any public funding, the projects will be very transparent, so people would see entrepreneurial graduates in action in real-world projects developing creative content. And so we need to get kind of the maximum bang for buck, if you like, by creating that goldfish bowl effect.
I wondered if you think there's a particular role for colleges. I mean, you mentioned universities, but it feels that there's colleges in particular are clearly under massive financial pressure, but whether there's something that there's pre-courses that get people to the point where it's one thing to be a bright young thing and think, well, I could be in the games industry, but perhaps for a young woman or whatever, somebody from a particular kind of community, they wouldn't think about that. Are there conversations, particularly with the colleges, about what are the skills before you get to the point where you would actually think about doing a degree, which would lead people to that? Because that, I think it's that sense, there's a rigour in other, you know, if you're going to do an engineering degree, there'd be things you could maybe offer at college that would get you to the right place to be able to do that. And I wondered if there's even that discussion in the sector around that.
If I can jump in, as I say, there are a growing number of colleges who are offering HNCs and HNDs in game development. And from my conversations with the colleges, it's an incredibly popular choice for young people. The reality in the wider world is that the tools and technologies to make games have never been more available and more accessible. There are tools out there now, many created in Scotland, which are free to download and use at home, which will allow you to build games just as good as the ones you see on your Apple smartphone or your tablet. And you can actually take that through and publish things. So the question is not how are we attracting more people into games. I think we're attracting an awful lot of people into games. It's ensuring that the colleges get the same support as the universities, ensuring that they've got the same strong ties with industry. Again, I believe this has to be industry-driven as well, just to ensure that we're getting the people coming out with the right skills and the right mindset. Again, entrepreneurialism, not just sitting in a small room for 5 years making stuff. But I think we do need to take a step back, as Paul says, and start looking at high school and start looking at encouraging far more diversity and ensuring that people are aware that the game sector can be a proper grown-up industry. I've spent the last 20 years trying to persuade my parents I've got a real job. Right? Yeah. It hasn't worked to date, but I've got high hopes. But again, it's like showing that games are not just about the hardcore coding and the hardcore art and animation, and that we do need the analytics, we do need the data analysts, we do need computer scientists, we do need all of these incredibly diverse and creative roles within the sector. And I don't think that's being communicated effectively. When it comes to the game sector in Scotland, we are still a little bit insular, a little bit isolated, and something of a black hole.
Just, I know Chris wants to say something, but just to pick up on that point about schools, Curriculum for Excellence, was designed to build in a lot of opportunity for interdisciplinary work, and and games provides fantastic opportunity for that, but teachers don't have the time or resources to really capitalize on a lot of these real world projects and bring them into the classroom and fill those interdisciplinary slots that are there in the design but don't seem to be being taken up very much in the classroom at the moment.
So thanks. Just the final thing I was going to say, Joanne, is it's the usual thing with any attractive industry, attractive job. If someone has no point of reference, that at school you say, you know, how would we ever get into that industry? Then they probably never will, because there's no idea how to get through there. What seems to be changing is actually the visibility of the games industry in Scotland. You know, we have people constantly coming through our door saying, you know, I live for Minecraft. I didn't realise Minecraft was made in Scotland. Can we come and see? And we obviously have to restrict the numbers of people we can give access to our studio, but we're always encouraging, and we've been supporting a project by Derek Robertson at University of Dundee to take Minecraft into schools, where he's using it as embedded in curriculum for excellence as a teaching tool. But interestingly, over the fact that we've now, you know, some of us are getting a bit of grey hair now, and we've been in the industry for sort of 20 years or so, we're actually seeing people who've taken career paths, unusual career paths. So with slightly larger studios, they've maybe come into us completely unqualified to test games or to start working on small bits of levels of games. Some of these guys, 20 years later, now have big global careers running studios, heading up some of the biggest game franchises in the world. And there's a new phenomenon that's appeared in the past few years, which you'll be aware of in other contexts, I'm sure. But that sort of video bloggers, people who are now starting to build careers out of commenting on games and building huge businesses out of that. There's a 16-year-old guy in Irvine at the moment who goes under the moniker of Elfer Lee, who's one of the most popular Minecraft YouTube characters on the planet. And these guys are building serious careers out of that now and not having to go through traditional paths. Actually, some of the courses like media studies, some of the core video production and things like that are actually teaching them skills that are now transferable and becoming a core part of the games industry. So it's ever evolving. I mean, it's back to this point of strategy. I don't think we can stamp out a one course that will do this games industry for the next 20 years. It's real core understanding that digital media and the skills associated are quite broad and generic, but they're skills that are well worth having right now, because some of the biggest and best opportunities anyone will see over the next 20 years will be within these industries.
Thank you.
I've got two members who want to come in with follow-ups on this question. First of all, Bruce Crawford, and then Richard Lowell. So, Bruce.
Thank you, Murdo. Fascinating discussion, gentlemen. Thank you for coming along today. I want to come to Brian with a particular question from your own paper and then broaden it out. First of all, obviously, I'm a slightly different chronological position to you, and it's my kids who don't believe I've got a real job rather than my parents. So, fascinating how you've got a situation, Brian, according to your paper, that describes a position where you've got more graduates than can be accommodated by the industry, but there are skill gaps. And that seems to say to me, when you sit alongside something that Daniel Livingston from Glasgow School of Art, or Brian Macdonald from the Glasgow Caledonian said, that although we're getting all these graduates, a lot of them are almost immediately leaving the Scottish scene to go elsewhere. And I guess that comes back to Chris's and your own discussion you were having about critical mass, about capacity, and about scale. And is Rockstar the beginning of, and in terms of the scale of what's going to happen across the road here, where is this going to go? And will we be able to retain a lot more of that talent in the future to help contribute to the Scottish economy? Because if we don't, others are going to get the benefit.
Boy, there's a big question. Okay, I'll go first. The nature of the industry has changed, as Chris stated earlier. In the early days, when we were all creating games for games-specific devices, home consoles and the like, you needed a large team. You needed a lot of upfront investment. And as a result of that, the studios that existed were quite big. Right? There were certainly 50 to 100, sometimes 250 people. That has changed. Again, the evolution of the industry has meant that the majority of game creation companies, game studios now, are under 10 people. And the reason for that is the majority of games are now being created for smartphones and tablets. So you don't need 150 people and X million pounds up front. You can now create a game for your Apple iPhone or your Android tablet with two guys, a good idea and some spare time. So the nature of the industry has changed quite dramatically. Now, that does not mean that companies cannot scale. If you look across the sector in Scotland, you will see a number of studios that have actually grown from very humble beginnings up to 30, 40, sometimes 50 people and above. But again, the weighting tends now to be towards the smaller studios. And in the smaller studios, you need more people who are multidisciplined. So if you're just in a really small studio, you might be the lead programmer but also have to do the marketing. Or you might also end up doing the payroll. Or you might be the one who's going out and doing the business development. So the small studios are having to combine multiple roles within individual people. The larger studios, because they are fewer and further apart, mean that we do have a problem with some senior staff. You know, there are people working with companies in Scotland, and if their particular company has problems or closes its doors, they're going to leave because there are very few other companies that can accommodate them. So it's an issue, but I think it's one that would be solved by the studios growing and becoming more sustainable. And that's certainly an area where we as an industry need to really focus on and try to make sure that we're producing these sustainable businesses that have the scalability to compete on a global market.
Thanks. I would probably take a slightly different view than Brian, but also I would agree with a lot of what he said. In that the smaller studios are quite prolific because it's so easy to start. It's so easy to say, like, we've got enough money to last us for 6 months. That's enough for us to get a game going. So it's inevitable that most of those guys aren't going to succeed. You know, they'll appear in the blaze of glory, put their game on the market, and then it won't sell and they'll find something else. And that's fine because some of those guys will succeed and there'll be some amazing things out of that. That's an additional strand to the industry that didn't exist. It's not a replacement strand. So it's not that people have stopped making games for consoles or games for PC and big high-budget games. It's just there's a new market that's appeared that didn't exist 7 or 8 years ago for games on phones and those devices. What has started to happen at the on the bigger console games is there's even more money going into them. So 50 million, 100 million, would be numbers touted around as to how much budget a Rockstar, for example, would spend. And economically, that has a huge impact because whether or not New York is gaining the lion's share of the revenue when the game goes on sale, there's enormous salaries and bonuses and taxes being paid in country right now by those businesses. And they are constrained by talent. And to your point, where is this dichotomy between we've got an oversupply of graduates but people are screaming for talent? Well, actually, there clearly is a bit of a mismatch. Undergraduates, in the point they just graduate, they're really still trainees. They're trainees that are coming into the industry, and if they're coming in a really skilled, high-end job, it will be a number of years before they are really contributing in a core part of the of a bigger studio. So a bigger studio will have a training program where it'll take maybe a year for a graduate, a couple of years, like any big company has a graduate training scheme. And when you want to grow quickly and instantly, you actually want people in at the at above a graduate level. And to that extent, I think we're reasonably well balanced in the undergraduate population. The industry just needs to grow a bit more. Now, there is a really interesting point in our inflection point in Scotland's digital history that we're going through right now. And that is, I term it, we have a couple of black swans swimming around. If you're familiar with the book that was quite popular a few years ago of, a black swan didn't exist until someone found one in the back end of Australia, so it was some perceived wisdom was it couldn't happen, and then suddenly it did, and suddenly there was a whole flock of them. And that happens in the digital industry a lot. In Scotland right now, we've got two amazing digital media businesses fundamentally based in Edinburgh, in FanDuel and Skyscanner, who are venture capital backed, both principally venture capital backed from Scotland and the United States of America, Silicon Valley, if you will, and both highly likely, both incredibly successful already, highly likely either to go for an IPO for billions of dollars or sell for billions of dollars. Right now, those companies are employing every talented digital media graduate and person that they can find or bring to Scotland, and are expanding outside Scotland at the same time. They're having a displacement effect to some of the games companies. People are being moving to those companies. But that's not a problem. That's just a challenge that we now need to address, because when these black swans become apparent to everyone, Scotland will become an attractant for international capital and digital media talent like we've never seen before. And we need to work out, and this is definitely a national question, how do we take advantage of that? How do we not look back in 10 years' time and say, well, you know, we had those two and a couple other things happened and then we're still where we are. How do we use this as our inflection point to become, you know, the Seattle of Europe? And I do believe those businesses will be significant to that, the businesses that spin out of them. But I think we have this other cluster of digital games businesses, which are the small ones all the way to the larger ones, who are screaming for that talent base. Now, it's going to come from there, but the other big question is, how do we attract and retain that talent from abroad? And not just, I mean, if I look at my own studio, 60, 70% of the staff are not Indigenous Scots. I didn't train and go to university for the first degree here. Some of them did postgraduates here, but most of them came in to work in this industry and then either directly for us or for others and moved to us. And it's the classic thing that happens, let's say in the finance sector, very high quality graduates come out of Scotland and go to London because there's a critical mass, you know, because if they don't work at Morgan Stanley, they can jump to Goldman's, they can jump to Societe Generale, whoever it is. We need the same thought here, because right now, if you want to do that in the games industry, then California is clearly the hotbed. There's thousands and thousands of companies that you could choose from over there. Canada has a few really big clusters in the same way. Scotland is right on the cusp of having the same thing. And it is a question that I'm not suggesting I could give you an answer to today, but how can we make Scotland a more attractive environment for those very mobile, generally young, but not necessarily all graduate age, dynamic individuals who can go anywhere, and we want them to choose Scotland. I think that's a key question that I think the whole nation can help us answer.
Just a very quick supplementary to that. Is this down to the games industry themselves to make this happen, or are there government interventions that can create that, enable that transformation to get us to the place that you envisage?
I think there are government interventions to me in three or four key areas. I think we're doing quite well around the fiscal support in a number of ways, both on a sort of systemic taxation and a laser intervention of grants and things like that. Strategy and signposting could help that perform a bit better, but I think we're doing pretty well on that. The other three areas are, please continue to fund education as strongly as possible in the widest possible way that we can, in the areas that support us. Immigration policy, I think, is crucial to this. We've got to be able to get high-quality talent with high-quality skills into Scotland instantly when we need them. We've got to be able to do that. And then the retention thing, that's a quality of life issue. That is about a healthier and fairer and more wonderful Scotland to be part of. And I do think in Dundee's case, if you look at the vision that's been shown by the government and the city council in terms of the waterfront regeneration, the V&A, the partnerships between the universities, and that's what's going to do it. You know, realising that vision will create a place where, you know, Dundee is already the UK leader in life sciences. We're not far off being the UK leader in this industry, and it's that kind of environmental regeneration, the place to be. And it's not just about Dundee, this is about the whole of Scotland. Then I think we can do it, and clearly there is a massive role to be played out with the industry and by government specifically in that.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you,
Kevin.
That says exciting jobs, but an exciting country at the same time to attract the people we need. Okay. Thank you.
I'm going to bring in Richard. Just before I do that, I just want to comment. We are two-thirds of the way through our time, and I'm halfway through the list of my questions. Which means that I know you've all got a lot to say and it's all extremely interesting, but if we can tighten up a little on the responses, that would be helpful. Richard.
Thank you very much, and really enjoying this discussion, gentlemen. But basically, I remember the first time I went into a game shop with my son, and he convinced me what the game was best for me to play and what to buy. So it's an exciting industry. It's a money-making industry. It's something really we need to get into. Can I ask you, basically I'm reading from some submissions. Scottish games industry needs to focus on translating the existing creativity and critical acclaim into solid commercial success. We have all these, and I wouldn't suggest you're a geek, by the way, as you said earlier on, excellent people who are developing excellent games, but they don't have the commercial, possibly in some within companies, to forward it on. Retain the talent in Scotland, simple answers to help teams find sustainable commercial success, and also a comment was made about locally in the city centre rather than out in an innovation park. But one of the interesting comments I saw was, should we create, and you were basically going on about this, Chris, create a national company for play that can help? You know, the funding maybe is there, the creativity is there, but do we need something to drive it on? I know you said earlier on that the industry can do that, drive on, but do we need a national company for play, like similar to the National Theatre, etc.?
If you want a minute to think, I know who submitted this, so I'm happy to.
I didn't want to name the person, but I will.
That's quite all right. I did my homework, I read them all.
David Thompson, director of Ludotronics.
Ludometrics, yeah.
Ludometrics, sorry.
One of the issues that we have at the moment is the game sector has reached the position it's in right now primarily through commercial success or lack thereof. And it is inherently risky to create new intellectual property. It's a risk. We don't know whether something's going to work. If you look at the big console market where the major publishers are funding things, it's all about minimising risk, which is why you have sequels and franchises and FIFA 15. And, you know, it's all the games that you know are going to sell, so you don't mind ploughing the millions of dollars of investment into it. Several of the companies within Scotland have had this discussion on an ongoing basis, which is, how do we innovate? How do we go out and explore? How do we work with theatre companies? How do we work with film, television, you know, authors? How do we work with musicians? And find new and interesting ways of using interactivity and using the devices that are out there. You know, your smartphone now is voice enabled, it's got HD video both ways, it's location aware, it's motion sensitive, and so great, you know, we can collect coins, rescue princesses and blow stuff up, we're good at that. But how do we actually try and move this forward and not only innovate in a playful way, but innovate in a way which can actually help draw all of the other creative industries together? And there are a growing number of people who suspect that it could be either a centre for play or a company which focuses on innovation and using digital media and interactivity in new ways. There are a number of examples around the world. Canada has several. Seattle, oddly enough, has a number where it's just big building, loads of free Wi-Fi, come along, join in, sit down, and essentially there's a small amount of funding there to let people go and explore and experiment. And it's out of those ideas and this innovation that you can then find the commercial success, and you can then find the scalability and sustainability to go out and make something totally awesome.
So I would say, you know, that idea chimes with Paul Durrant's talked about it, you know, what the prototype fund was, and that kind of, you know, risk money, you know, and it's small, tiny little lumps of it that people can go and just try stuff and do stuff and experiment and innovate. And I do believe that can be done within an academic environment if it's funded properly. It could be done independently. That's all fine. So I wouldn't argue against that. I do think we already do very well in co-funding alongside privates. So the Scottish Investment Bank also has a co-investment policy, which has been very successful around games. So we have companies like Outplay, who are funded by Pentec in Edinburgh, who access that, you know, access Scottish government investment through that co-investment route. And what you don't want to do is suggest that we can suddenly magically create an organisation that will be able to pick hits, because we absolutely cannot. You know, the biggest companies in the world find it difficult to do that. How we could possibly dream that we could set something up that could be, oh, there's the three guys in the back of Glenrothes that will do it, we'll back them. They just have to find their own way to market. But if there's ways that they can try stuff out in a good environment, but I do think putting that kind of accelerator incubator structure around them so they're not just left to sit in a corner and try stuff. They've got people who can peer mentor them about, hey, listen, you might be having fun on that, but where's the funding going to be from in 3 months? You better get out talking to the funders now. You better build a prototype that people can play. You know, who do you know? Oh, I don't know anybody. Well, here's who I can introduce you to. And those kind of models, just getting like-minded people around are brilliant. I think the other thing is, of course, there would be a wonderful place for Indigenous publishing organisations to start. And I think if you look at companies like Outplay, you look at companies like TAG, they're trying to create that kind of model at the moment as well. I mean, ourselves, you know, we have generated and earned a lot of capital from the industry that we want to look for projects to invest in and expand our own, you know, our own business, but only at the right time and in the right way. So it's not going to be a magic wand that will suddenly have 1,000 new games companies funded tomorrow. You know, these kind of things will do one or two a year, which is the way it is. If you look at the big publishers, you know, it's very akin to the film industry or the television industry or the music industry. You know, there might be a lot of activity going on, but when you hone it down, there are 1,000 times more people trying to break in than are actually funded. So it isn't that it's unhealthy. I think what we're trying to say is, how can we help ourselves hyper-perform relative to others out there? And by the way, this isn't a bleating session, as I said right at the start. We're doing really well as a sector. In 15 or 20 years, we've grown one of the world's most recognised clusters for games development with, as was said earlier, at least two of the biggest selling entertainment, not just games, entertainment franchises in the world developed here in Scotland today. So that's a brilliant springboard for future success.
Sure. Thank you.
Okay.
Gordon.
Thanks, convener. Good morning.
We've touched upon this morning the support that you get from the likes of Scottish Enterprise, Business Gateway, etc. What type of business support is available? How effective is it? And more importantly, if we're going to continue to grow the sector, where are the gaps that need to be plugged in order to continue to grow?
I mean, from my point of view, there's a fairly broad range of support available. You know, Scottish Enterprise has a number of different grants. There's a number of people have won business from TSB. There's been some games involvement with Creative Scotland. I think there are gaps. I think things could be more joined up, but for me it comes back to this entrepreneurial thing, that it's the people that are accessing these funding sources are the entrepreneurial types. They're not necessarily, I don't mean this in a bad way, they're not necessarily the most deserving, they're not the most creative, sometimes they are, but for me it's about opening up the sources that are available to everyone else. So some of that signposting, but I think more of it is about getting that spirit in our new creators that are coming through, the new teams. So I think things like Prototype, like Dare to Be Digital, that's fostering an environment where people are thinking on their feet and are figuring out, okay, you know, right, where do I get funding for this? How can I take this? And rather than thinking about what's the next technical challenge, I've already built this, how can I exploit this? How can I sweat this asset? So there are gaps, but to me that's not the main problem. I think we can do more to foster that entrepreneurialism, and those people will then go out and find the funding that's out there.
Yeah, I'd agree it's much better to create this kind of real world environment with small amounts of funding that allow real projects to happen, where, you know, it's as has been said clearly, it's not about picking winners, but the greater the volume of original IP being developed, the higher the chances that something will bubble up to the surface and be spectacularly successful. But whilst all of that's happening, there's a huge amount of real-world learning from all of those engaged, and some of the graduates who we've heard aren't yet oven ready become oven ready by the time that they're, you know, they've worked through perhaps a little startup of their own that may fail. They perhaps just get a single title out there that doesn't do anything. But that takes a huge amount more experience to an interview with a larger company, and they'll probably then get hired because they'll be able to talk through that story. So it's coming back to the previous point about whether you need some sort of entity, some institution that's a kind of established. I think we don't. I think it's much more about creating this sort of unbounded thing. As soon as you start drawing boundaries around it and creating metrics, etc., for it, then you have a problem. We need something that's much more fluid than that, so we can capitalise on the things that none of us here know about, but are going to be spectacular successes in this sector in the years to come.
If I may, just very, very quickly. I think we actually suffer from an embarrassment of riches when it comes to the public sector in Scotland. You know, we have Scottish Enterprise, SDI, HIE, Talent Scotland, Interactive Scotland. On the previous point, Arts and Business Scotland is one I came across recently. At my last count, there are between 25 and 30 public and private sector organisations who are actively trying to help the games sector in some way. Just finding out what they do and how they can help is essentially a full-time job. You know, so I think Colin was right. A large part of it's signposting, but it's the visibility, the transparency that will actually allow the people who need to find this information and find out, you know, the difference between Scottish Enterprise, SDI, Skills Development Scotland, and then Creative Scotland, who we haven't even touched on yet. It can be a real, real, you know, significant stumbling block when it comes to where do we go next. So I think we do need to improve the information that's available and the visibility of all of the above.
Right. In terms of funding, obviously part of the funding would be from international sales, and we've already talked about the fantastic successes of Minecraft, Lemmings, you know, Grand Theft Auto 5. What kind of support do you receive to help with overseas sales? And, you know, is it the correct kind of support? Because reading through some of the written evidence, one comment is, we found the support provided by Scottish Development International in particular to be of utmost importance and value. But another director commented, SDI are responsible for helping games companies attend industry conferences such as the Game Developers Conference, but have no flexibility for helping companies attend consumer-focused events. So have you got the right kind of support in place in terms of SDI, etc.?
I think if I refer back to an answer or a point I made earlier about Scottish Enterprise's initial foray into supporting us, it was all around E3 and helping Scotland become a coherent brand. And it was, I mean, it's not to be overlooked how sort of seminal a moment for the Scottish games industry that was, and how different from everyone else that was. You know, there was no other countries banded together on one stand, paying for space at a big international trade show when it was Sony and Microsoft and Scotland right beside them. And very quickly, you know, Canada, the rest of you, we had colleagues in the rest of the UK screaming that this was unfair at the time. And, you know, that was great. It was a brilliant initiative by Scotland, and we really stole the march on people and benefited greatly. That continued support, I think, is really important. I think it's worth making sure we dovetail properly with UKTI, because UKTI are doing a pretty good job around similar things. But support to go to these big international trade shows, and not just go and attend, because anyone can do that, but go and attend with a brand behind you. If you're two guys in a shed in Dundee, you know, you're turning up and you're brand Scotland and you're being introduced to the right people, you've got credibility. I think they do a phenomenal job there. Interestingly, when it comes to export markets, we don't have the same challenges as, you know, food and drink or engineering, in that when it comes to exporting our product, we press a button and it appears wherever it needs to appear. And the global distribution networks that Apple have, that Sony and Microsoft have, and all these people, are actually relatively easy to access. We wouldn't say they're relatively easy to become the number one in, but they're relatively easy to access. It's a small number of conversations that you have to have. And peers in the industry will be a far better source of more contemporary contacts in those companies than an SDI or anyone ever can. I think what that person's possibly alluding to is the fact that in such a fast-moving industry, what was a market last year for guys that make games for games consoles, it's completely irrelevant for people that are trying to make a game aimed at 18 to 25 year old females that's going to be on a phone. They actually want to be at some glamour fashion show, so they want support to get to that. So there probably is a case for saying, you know, digital media games guys may pop up and appear in unusual places. And actually, the one thing you do need to do if you're going to be successful in this industry is be global from day one. You know, you cannot think about Scotland as a primary market or the UK as a primary market. You have to think about an international market from the very, you know, the minute you get up. And right now, clearly in mobile and smartphone, Asia and the Asian subcontinent is the growth market. You know, and China is opening up, as we all know, at an incredibly rapid rate. And that's a place where specialisms in somewhere like SDI, cultural specialists, could really help us, because there'll be very, very few people in the games industry will have the right networks into those emerging markets.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And really following up on some of that, because
I think it's interesting stuff, but it also takes us back to the convener's original questions about strategy and direction, because I think everyone answering Murdo Fraser's question said strategy needs to belong to the industry, which I think is sensible. I think Colin used the term shepherding, that in spite of that industrial, the industry owning a strategy, there has to be somebody there who can shepherd the industry and how that actually works. Some of the evidence suggests, I think it's an ESTA finding, that Scotland does relatively well on the high-tech side and less well on the creative side in terms of competition with other peers. And in terms of the public sector landscape, I think you've described there are a lot of players. It's not entirely clear that there's a lead player. Should there be? And if so, who should it be? Is Creative Scotland engaged in the way that is most effective? And what about something like a national digital network? That's a suggestion made in one of the other submissions. Is there a need for the different agencies already engaged to pool their knowledge in a new way in order to provide that kind of shepherding function that Colin Macdonald talked about?
If I can jump in initially. I think one of the biggest issues that the sector has within Scotland at the moment is a lack of clarity over the different organisations and what they have to offer. On the Creative Scotland issue, they do not have any legacy of working with the games industry. The Scottish Arts Council certainly didn't. Scottish Screen, you know, I had only really started talking to them when the whole merger process took place. Now, the organisation has actually funded a small number of projects and award categories and the like in the past, but they certainly don't have any in-house experience with interactive media or any real focus. Their 10-year strategy that was released towards the end of last year mentioned, you know, we're all about digital, we're all about innovation, but, you know, having picked it apart, there's very little in there that you can drill down into and say, yeah, these guys get it. You know, and the whole idea of interactive media as transformative technology that can help all of the other areas of the creative industries. You know, you'll be hearing from people in the film sector. Let them come and talk to us about distribution. As Chris says, we can put it on, you know, smartphones and devices around the world at the push of a button. So there are a lot of solutions that interactivity that can offer. And at the moment, we don't have any one agency that encompasses that sort of knowledge or has that kind of vision. So I think potentially something like a national digital agency could at least start, you know, hooking all of these different organisations together and at least start putting together some sort of vision and very, you know, rapidly evolving and iterative strategy for the country. So, yeah, that sounds like a good plan to me.
For me, I think Colin Anderson made the point about the National Digital Network, and I'd be careful not to confuse that with some digital agency. The biggest benefit in my sort of serendipitous model about having something like that and capitalising on what was possibly a missed opportunity around the time of the Scottish Broadcasting Commission report that suggested that, is that at least you'd create some kind of commissioning pool and home market that could feed into this whole sort of wealth of small teams and original IP generation. And for me, that's one of the biggest benefits of seeing some kind of national digital network and Scotland perhaps becoming a leader in having something like that.
Chris, briefly come in, convener, please. Luce, the one thing I would counsel against is creating an agency or something just for the sake of creating an agency. I think if you look inside Scottish Enterprise, and Scottish Enterprise has also been radically restructured over the past few years, you'll still find a core of individuals who really understand the sector, who know it, and are capable of leadership and facilitation of leadership, the kind of shepherding role that Colin talked about, if they were given the right mandate. So I think there is an organisation and individuals within that organisation with the right structure. They've probably been restructured out of existence in terms of being recognisable as that. But if they were modestly supported, then I'm sure we could find the right structure to put around that to help us nail this strategy down and then start to do. And it is this: how do we connect all these multiple agencies up? Because actually, from my perspective, I think I wouldn't want to take Janet Archer at Creative Scotland away from a core mission that she's deeply involved in, to start worrying too much about expansion and industrial challenges for the games industry. That's not, in my view, the role of Creative Scotland. However, should Creative Scotland as an arts organisation be engaging, as Brian's suggesting, with this whole new world? Of course they are, and they are already, but what more could we do? And that's with a sort of almost a pure art form, which I always see as the initial ideas that then become the commercial successes of the future. So one shouldn't ignore that. So they've all got a place to play. But somebody sitting right at the centre of that and coalescing it, we've probably got an agency that can do it if we talk to the right people.
Okay. Lewis? Okay, fine.
Thanks very much, convener. We've explored quite usefully, I think, some of the ways in which the industry has changed and some of the ways it might change and the pace at which it changes. And I suppose I'm left with a slight concern that, even if we got the right package of business support services and engagement strategies and so on, even if we got that right, then in a year it might be clearly completely wrong because of the pace at which the industry is changing. So I'd like to talk about the scale and structure of it. Just very quickly on a purely factual point, we've got two reports in front of us here, both from September 2014, one from Nesta saying that Scotland's got 5% of the UK games companies located here, and one from Tiger saying that we've got nearly 12%. Is that just because people can't pin it down and it's changing so rapidly that no one's quite sure, or is there someone else going on there?
Sorry, Paul, you go.
I was only going to say, in the context of the Nesta report, my understanding is that this was their first attempt at a sort of broader classification of games companies, whereas Tiger have been very focused on their membership, with perhaps the more conventional description of games companies. So that might account for the slight discrepancy, I think.
So they've cast the net wider, but what they're finding, more of that's down south and less of it's in Scotland, is that?
I think they're trying to address the discrepancy around SIC codes and those, the way that companies kind of register themselves and declare stats.
Yeah, the games industry has suffered from a lack of hard data for some time, UK-wide, but specifically here in Scotland. The last official report that was the 2012 Economic Impact Survey commissioned by Creative Scotland and Scottish Enterprise found that there were less than 200 people in the games industry and it was worth zero. Now, I had issues with that, and I think indirectly led to me being here today. But, we still don't have any official numbers. It's the SIC code is the normal route that people use. But there are a tremendous variety of companies out there. The diversity is increasing daily. The Nesta report actually used data scraping from the internet. So I would tend to think that's going to be slightly more accurate.
Well, that diversity is something I'd like to explore, and the structure of the industry as opposed to just the scale. And I'll refer back to the submission that was mentioned earlier from Ludometrics, which suggests that while two kind of categories of companies might have existed for quite a long time, one that does work for hire, they might do a bit of animation for games one month and adverts the next month or what have you, and they might scale up and scale down, but that's basically what they do. And another that's looking for growth and to be the next big thing and might have some venture capital funding or what have you. he's arguing that there's a third category which should be understood more like a band in relation to the music industry, and that, you know, people, some of whom might well harbour the ambition that one day they'll create the next big thing, they'll have the next GTA or the next Minecraft, and they'll take over the office that used to be occupied by something called a newspaper, right? Some of them, though, are the people who have maybe been slightly talked down about in this conversation, the folk who do want to spend their lives in the room coming up with cool stuff, or who, you know, are a couple of folk in their back room who are doing that and don't necessarily judge their success on becoming the next big global thing. And to take Paul's used, I think, twice or three times the metaphor of an ecosystem, they're the healthy soil, and out of that something fantastic might well grow. But if you're only obsessed with the size of the thing that grows, then you'll end up destroying the healthy soil. So do we not need to value and recognise that layer of people who are not necessarily going to be the next big thing, because that's where the skills and the creativity and the enthusiasm is coming from?
Indeed we do. And this is one of the biggest changes that's occurred within the UK industry, but again in the Scottish industry in the last few years, is the growth of smaller companies, which Dave refers to as boutique companies, who aren't interested in scaling, who aren't interested in, you know, actively going out and becoming the next GTA, but who are quite happy to sit and make games and find funding and do work for hire to fund themselves. And it is a lifestyle choice. People get into the games industry because they want to make games. And so, yes, I do think that there is a very important part of the sector that may be overlooked if we don't recognise that that's a valid choice for many, many people coming into the games in Scotland.
So that being the case, is there an argument for saying that we're not just talking about business support services in the conventional sense, but thinking about games or interactivity as a medium through which communication happens? There's a huge amount of money that public bodies spend on communicating things to people. We met a few of them, a few companies at the showcase on Wednesday, who are working with public bodies. I think in one case a health organisation, some with charities, and the games there are not just commercial products; they're methods of communicating. Is there not a case for thinking about that kind of relationship with the sector, rather than just thinking about business support for folk to grow?
Absolutely, and this is one of my big contentions, is that we need to stop thinking about the rescuing princesses thing. Okay, games are moving far beyond that. Interactive media, again, transformative technology. And we do have a number of companies, Quartic Llama and Dundee, who are Abertay graduates, worked with the National Theatre of Scotland, to create a game that you can only experience by walking around Dundee. Right? There are no graphics. We have Guerrilla Tea in Dundee and Chunk in Glasgow, who have worked with Cancer Research UK using real-world clinical data specifically to try and speed up research into a cure for cancer. Games are moving far beyond the old models and the ways that we tend to think about them. When you look at the industry, we have this morning focused on games developers. We also need to be aware that there are tools, technologies, analytics companies, animators, musicians, you know, audio producers, motion capture studios. There is a whole ecosystem out there around the game sector. And if you look at games-related companies, you know, at my last count, Scotland had something like close to 170 games-related companies, or companies who are working with games to some greater or lesser degree. So I absolutely think that, as Paul was saying, the fluid nature, if it's just you are a game developer, you can access this kind of support, is the wrong way to go, because that is starting, you know, or maintaining the silo mentality, which will not actually accommodate the rapid evolution within the industry.
Patrick, if you got the impression that we were talking down people are in the, let's call it, this band structure, then apologies, because that certainly wasn't an impression I wanted to put over. There's a broader ecosystem and there's issues at different levels, but if you take that band idea, It's alive and thriving. If one looks at about 10 years ago, there was received wisdom in the industry was, you know, it's probably time to shut up shop unless you're owned by a giant publisher with infinite pockets, because games budgets are going to be 100 million. And if you can't make a game for 100 million, forget it. And then phones came along, and then indie publishing and platforms like Steam came along, which gave people access to global markets instantly. And in the middle of that, and actually more broadly, the internet. Because of the internet and the ubiquity of the internet, up in Stockholm, a bedroom programmer came up with probably his 20th game. He was working for another games company, King.com, who make Candy Crush during the day, and at night he was coding his own games. And the game was Minecraft. And he never took a penny of external funding. He just sweated blood and tears until he couldn't sweat anymore. So he put a call out to his small fan base and said, if you paid a little bit, and I know it's not finished, I might have enough to stop working for part of my day job and go part-time. And the rest is history. Very quickly, he had an enormous income stream coming from the outside world. Now, what happened several years later, I think probably 5 years later, that business had grown so big that Marcus Persson, sometimes known as Notch, Marcus had created this effectively monster that he never set out to do. You know, he wanted to be a bedroom programmer and hang out with his indie fans. So what they did 4 months ago, as was probably quite well known, is sold the company to Microsoft for $2.5 billion, with not $1 of external financing, not 1 minute of government intervention in Sweden, just one guy in a bedroom, who then built a slightly bigger bedroom and a slightly bigger a bigger business. Indeed. But I think the point is there to say that there is no lack of recognition of the importance of the fresh talent that are these bands that are coming through. And the next Minecraft will probably come from one of those. I think that's a huge part of the ecosystem.
The point I was making is that the ones who don't create the next Minecraft, but who carry on being that, as I described it, that fertile soil.
Absolutely.
Are still crucially important to the future.
Vitally important, and vitally important to the whole ecosystem.
Yeah.
You know, in our studio, we've got a couple of guys who are trying to build businesses themselves, but are coming to get some money to work for us for a while, and we know they'll probably go off and do their own thing. That's fine. That's this kind of creative, and it is that brilliant blend between huge amounts of creativity, technical talent, and then entrepreneurial spirit and management to grow these businesses. And if we have a thriving ecosystem, we need it top to toe. You know, we need the huge companies, we need the tiny companies, we need the entrepreneurial characters that are bringing new stuff through, we need access to markets and this ability. And Scotland, I believe, is one of these places in the world that has a fairly unique blend of creativity and visual talent, technology talent, and chutzpah and entrepreneurial drive. You know, we maybe need more of it, but we certainly have it.
That's very helpful, thank you.
Paul, do you want to come in?
Patrick's analogy one step further. If you think about the way that those searching to address the problem of antibiotic resistance have turned to the soil to find the gems, to find the organisms that are going to crack that problem, having that kind of fertile ecosystem means that we'll always have the potential for some kind of gems to be found and discovered and turn into something big for Scotland.
All right, briefly, Dennis Roberts.
A very brief supplementary, and you know, I think Chris, you touched on them very early on, but again, some of the discussion that's really following on from Patrick's analogies here is the world of gaming is moved on, and I think Chris, you mentioned the early stages about health, tourism, all that sort of thing. Do you see it as an opportunity for obviously education, early learning for our young people, obviously maybe later on down the ageing stream, and it does happen already, obviously, to keep maybe older people alert and active by using it. But people with, say, learning disabilities, or, and this is the confession, I've never played a game, computer games at all, regardless of the fact that I use an iPhone 6. It's because, you know, are we looking at the world of people, say, who have sensory impairment, a learning disability? What are the opportunities to take that forward, to engage, not just as a game, but maybe just as a learning tool as well?
I'll try to be unlikely, but I'll be as quick as I can. To let my colleagues come in, but the games industry, I mean, it is the most powerful and engaging form of entertainment in the world. You know, when you get somebody with the right game experience in front of them, it'll engage them like no other form of entertainment. And it's been used in education very, very successfully. back to Minecraft. Minecraft is the single biggest educational tool in the world now. Minecraft.edu is enormous. One of Microsoft's main reasons for investing in Minecraft was its future in education. In terms of individuals who've got various impairments or learning difficulties, we've been blown away by the response we've had from our fans around kids who are either on the autistic spectrum or have other challenges in life. Minecraft being a method of communication that they've been able to, use, unlike no other, and it's not just limited to us. Across the spectrum, there are huge examples of games being used in both in therapies and also in educational contexts. And there are a number of charities around the game sector who try and help us as games developers and also the games industry adapt and develop. Games that work. So it's, and it's a huge, huge area and one that Scotland should excel in even further.
No, just to echo that, I think we're seeing games used in a huge number of sectors. I think education and accessibility is huge, but I think there's almost not an industry where that isn't taking something from games. There's now the gamification industry. So, yes to education, yes to accessibility, but it doesn't stop there.
Yeah, surely. I have been coming to a whole bunch of different events, parliamentary, public sector and so on, for the last several years, and I was always the guy standing in the corner because people would go, and what do you do? Oh, and I would slink away because there was someone more important to speak to. Now, an awful lot of the interest that I'm getting is from outside the games sector. And it's from people in education, it's from people in politics, it's from people in all of the various public sector bodies. Healthcare and working with people with various disabilities or learning impairments is a huge, huge area. You know, we're talking about devices that are ubiquitous, that are in everyone's pockets. And as Chris and Colin have said, we're only now starting the process of doing this. Last week we invited along a project from Abertay University, which is specifically for people with various sight impairments and creating games for them in ways that they can interact without having, you know, full 20/20 vision or with having a number of different complaints. We have been, as Scotland, a pioneer in using games for education. Derek Roberts and the Consularium have done this for a number of years. I think the problem, again, is we don't really hear about it too much.
Is it because you market it as games?
They have tended not to be commercial releases, Dennis. Yeah. And again, one very last point, one of my big issues within Scotland is that we're not taken seriously as an industry. You know, yesterday there was a huge big piece in The Scotsman, which I know you all read, talking about crisis in the film industry and, you know, MSPs call in the film sector. If anyone actually covers this today, especially The Scotsman and The Herald, I will be gobsmacked. So the problem is you're not reading an awful lot about it, right? But we are doing an awful lot and there's so much more that we can do. And again, the whole idea of innovating beyond the essential entertainment side of things is something that can only go up and onwards, outwards into a global market.
Okay, great. Okay, well, on that note, I think we have to call it a day. We are over our time slightly, but I think it's been a fascinating session. I think we've all learned a lot. And on behalf of the committee, can I thank all four of you for coming along and answering our questions. And the committee will be taking evidence for another 2 or 3 weeks on the subject. And in due course, we will be producing a report. At this point, the committee will move into private session and we'll have a short suspension. Okay.